Welcome to the Veritas Forum, engaging university students and faculty in discussions about life's hardest questions and the relevance of Jesus Christ to all of life.
Thanks very much. We're talking about race, faith, and empathy tonight. And we're actually continuing a conversation. I'm going to set the stage a little, Bill, by reminding our USC community that this is a part of an ongoing conversation we've been having about race, social justice, faith, dating back at least to 2007-8 when along with Ron Garrett here on campus, put on a program called Race, Rap, and Redemption. Redemption figuring centrally in our thinking about the relationship between crime and our worries about crime and our propensity to stereotype and how we even think about wrongdoers. And as part of that, the key question we had for the night for this community over in Bovard, it was full crowd, full house of SC folk. Our call of the question for the night was, should we pour liquor for Tukey? Stanley Tukey Williams had just been put to death by then Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger after the governor refused his plea for commutation on the basis of, and this was what he wrote in the letter, his failure to achieve personal redemption. That is the stated criterion that he uses, and you can Google that and kind of check. It's a fascinating read, 3-page letter, right? And so what we mean by redemption is a important, critical, legal criterion, standard that we have to think about. And so we ask ourselves that night, should we as a USC community express through ritual that pouring of the libation, solidarity with a cold-blooded killer named Stanley Tukey Williams who helped start the Crips, right? One of the founders, and was, no question about it, a cold-blooded killer. Right, so anything that's going to reconcile us with a cold-blooded killer is going to take revolutionary morality for us as a community. We're talking about revolutionary morality, and that's when I had to go to the Bible to find the revolutionary morality that could help us as a community stand in solidarity with the likes of a Stanley Tukey Williams, who wasn't that different from Saul before he became Paul, who was on the road to Damascus to kill some more innocent people. Right, and so there, Ron Garrett got into a lot of those kinds of discussions, and we as a community, by the end of the night, we had Ice Cube perform live, Maida DeValle, Saul Williams, Lula Washington Dance Company did an Alvin Ailey-style dance to Tupac Shakur's Brenda's Got a Baby, so that people could relate to her narrative and through art come to connect with some of these people like Stanley Tukey Williams. By the end of the night, just about everyone I can recall in Bovard was standing up with, back in those days, you put your lighters in the air. I don't know what the practice is these days, but in 2007-8, they were still putting their lighters in the air in solidarity with, through the redemption after the, Ron Garrett did a sermon based on Jesus Walks, Kanye's Jesus Walks, and what he was saying about relating to the dispossessed and what the Christian response to that was really all about. And so it was a transformative experience, I think, for some of us who were able to share. And then finally we had, I'm just gonna say this real quickly and then get to the real question, just to, again, give some background on what these conversations we've been having here at USC. 2 years ago, I moderated a town hall meeting that was called after 79 riot police broke up a black graduation party right around the corner from campus. I had students, I had all the top LAPD brass were there, the police commission, everyone was up on the platform, and I was taking questions from the audience of students, after everyone had said their piece, and the white students said, we want to speak first. And the black students said, yeah, let them speak first. They took the mic and they said, we were having a party at the same decibel level as that black party across the street. The police came to our house and said, could you turn that down? They went to their house, and next thing you know, there were 79 riot police breaking up their party. It was like a controlled experiment. Same decibel level, same rowdiness. Only difference is the racial identity of the USC party goers. And when they said that, it was one of those moments, again, when we as a community just said, whoa, you know, we were holding up a looking glass to ourselves and wondering about, because we had smoking gun. You know, you're an empiricist. You know, we had the controlled experiment. So now, Bill, race, empathy, and faith. Help me out. Help us out. You know, how is empathy fitting into all of this? You're coming from the epicenter of it now. You know, St. Louis. You know, we're not just talking Michael Brown, but Tamir as well, and Eric Garner, and Kendrick McDade over here in Pasadena. The list goes on. You know, it's a roll call. Help us grapple with this in terms of faith, empathy, and social justice.
Wow, I didn't know that was the first question. So let's start from the beginning for me. There are several things that I do in my work that help me to understand this. The first one is everything that has guided my work over the last decade has been around the question of who is my neighbor. So the notion of neighbor, many of you who are in urban planning know this, this was constructed, we created the concept of neighbor in the US context, and that was someone who lives in close proximity, you know, and then we built everything around that, right? So we designed our schools to be neighborhood schools, and we designed community centers, and a whole tax structure is built on your proximity to the people around you. And the resources you get is called the benefit principle in economics. You benefit if you can pay the taxes, and if you can't pay the taxes, you don't benefit, right? Everything's built off of that in the US context. But there is another definition of neighbor, which comes out of Luke, and basically it's the Good Samaritan story. And the great question that emerges from that is, who is my neighbor? The lawyer seeking to approve himself is asking Christ, who is my neighbor? And then, you know, it's this powerful story about a hated Samaritan who goes and, after some people in in-groups, pass another person in an in-group. And they have no sympathy at all for the person, but this hated, it was racial, Christ knew what he was doing. It was a raced scenario where he took this hated ethnic group and allowed that person to be the example who would go in and take someone in an out group and provide them all the help that that person would need, left money for the innkeeper and the like. In other words, a neighbor was defined as someone who you can do good for. I think the very foundations of the social sciences have been about that question. So if you look at sociology, it's all about who my neighbor is. If you look at psychology, it's all about how does my neighbor think. Every single one of our disciplines really unfolds with this question about who is our neighbor. Public policy is about who we decide we're going to do something for. That's what public policy is. Who are we going to help? So ultimately, in my own work, I began to take both these ideas, who you live around, and who you can do good for, and try to manifest them in geospatial mapping. For those of you who like mapping, that's what you can do. And then you can ask questions, very important public policy related questions. But I became frustrated because I realized just holding up the data was insufficient. No one is moved just by the data. We know that, those of us who work in political scenarios, evidence is important, but it stops short. And I started to ask myself, why? Why is it when you can show people in their own neighborhood things that are happening geospatially, disparities and the like, that no one has moved? It's because they don't have empathy. And then I went back to the empirical work, as we talked about in our prior conversations. And if you, those of you who are in neuroscience, you know this, there are parts of the brain that fire off empathy. And in and out groups, when they stick needles in people, literally you can see them just jamming the needle into a person's hands. If a person is in the out group, there is that it does, nothing goes off. You don't feel any empathy for them. But if they're in your in group, it fires off. Now, this to me was a huge revelation because the scriptures talk about the flesh. And in my mind, I start saying, it's the flesh. There's a problem with the flesh. There needs to be some type of transformation before you actually can look at somebody who you define as in an outgroup and actually have empathy for them. And I think that's what the Christian perspective is about. It's about this transformation so that you can see people who you might not have initially identified with as being part of somebody who you can do good for, and boom, neurologically it transforms your flesh and you can do good in that. And that was for me a revelation point. That's where my scholarship and my faith began to make sense to me in a real way. And I'm a pretty old guy. And it took a long time to get this journey. That's the beauty of being a social scientist and not a mathematician. They burn out after 30, but we get better in the social sciences at 50 and 60. But
yes.
Yes, you have to. But I started putting all this together, and then Ferguson happened, right? And it dawned on me, and as you and I talked about, you know, the Rodney King scenario, and if you put a picture of the Rodney King up after that incident, and I would talk to my friends, and they would say, well, he was moving, you know, things like that, and, you know, this man's taking a beating I've never seen in my life. And I said, they can't have empathy because this man is in an out-group in their minds. And and that's when all this started to really, like I say, start coming together for me. Why wouldn't you have empathy for a young man who is tragically shot? Whatever the circumstances, you don't feel for his family, you don't feel that loss. There's something wrong, there's a disconnect there. You know, we saw the video of the man in New York, Eric Garner, you know, strangled. That's when people started to say, because they could see it in real time, even if you were, you don't even have to have any religious inclination because you could see that in real time. I started feeling like people may have empathy, but for me, ultimately, the transformation is in the faith walk and then looking at the evidence, having empathy and then saying, I need to do good for people. And that's what it's been about for me. That's the struggle for me.
I feel, okay, great, Bill. Let me ask you and push back a little bit now on whether, and I love your metaphor, you know, your analogy when it comes to our biases as being part of our flesh. That what we're talking about when we're talking about the mirror neurons that aren't firing. And because they're not firing, you're not simulating in your own brain what's going on with the person you're observing. That's the data you're talking about. And therefore, the very building blocks of empathy are missing. So you don't feel their pain. You literally don't feel their pain as you're observing. So all of that is powerful, but what you're pointing out is it's all rooted in the cognitive unconscious.
Yes.
Right? And so it's part of our brain makeup, it's part of the flesh in that sense, but it's also, it seems out of our control. It's happening at the level of reflexes, of habits, mental habits, of well-learned sets of associations that go back to, you know, our pre-age of judgment times and that sort of thing. So how do people gain any kind of control over their unconscious, automatic, you know, processes like that so that they can look at somebody from the out-group and say, I am going to feel their pain. I can feel their, not just I'm going to, I am, because what you're telling me is a lot of this is going on unconsciously. They're not intending to discriminate. They're not bad people trying to find any reason to discriminate. It's happening unconsciously.
And I think that's liberating. I absolutely believe that's a liberating point. And then once you recognize that, you have to ask yourself, how am I going to transform the way I view my own identity relative to other people so that I might do good for them? And I think for me, and other people may have other ways of doing it, but I'm from the South Side of Chicago. It was highly divisive racial context in which I grew up. If I had stayed in that mindset that I had as a very young person, I would not be able to do good for all people regardless of race, because my identity was locked in a space that would not allow me to see more broadly. And so I feel like through the study of the scriptures, through that process, I've transformed my view, sort of a Philippians point of view, where I no longer am moved by my own selfish ambitions, but actually in a desire to serve others. It helps me to actually see better the circumstances. So I heard one of our presenters talk about, you know, you drive around LA, you put your sunglasses on. I can't do that anymore. I'm not saying anything negative about her. I'm saying that I literally feel it. I go whether I go into a rural area and see rural poverty in Mississippi, or whether I'm going through North St. Louis, when I see it, I am moved. I cannot not feel it. And I believe it's because I've really prayed and really tried to study that I might feel others. Because they're human. And the big thing, you and I talked about this, the big thing about a neighbor is you will never view someone as a neighbor if you don't view them as human. And in at its very core, if we see people suffering and there's no response, it's really, you need to ask yourself, am I viewing them as a human? Because that's the level, at a meta level, you need to be operating on in this sort of transformation that I think you have to go through. And if you don't see people as human, then you can walk through any place and it doesn't bother you at all. You just become cold and you're left to that state of being. But I personally prefer to feel, along with, you know, I'm an empiricist, get the data, right? So it's that combination of actually having empathy and getting good data so that I could do good. And that's been the journey for me.
Let me think of a couple examples that we may all be familiar with, and where there might have been empathy deficits, like you described,
yes,
that we collectively expressed and maybe could have, should have, or will in the future hopefully try to overcome. I remember 9/11. Some of the older heads in here remember 9/11 as vividly as I do. And I remember the response. It was immediate. Our hearts went out. People just got it done. They didn't want to hear about red tape. They didn't want to hear about bureaucratic anything. It was get it done. These are our people. Right? These are Americans. 2006, Katrina. I see Sean Penn paddling up there 4 days into Katrina with bottles of fresh water. The government still can't get it together to get down to those black folks in the Ninth Ward, right, who are in dire distress. You have the pictures of them standing on roofs. It's clear that this is just a horrid situation. And there's not the same panic of empathy on the part of we as a collective to get it done for those black folk in the Ninth Ward. And when I think about mass incarceration over the last 30 years, in some of these neighborhoods, we're talking 90%. I just wrote this down. I had a double check, and they wanted me to pinpoint site in the law review. They called me back, we want to, because this, it's such, you're talking about neighborhoods, it's such a staggering statistic. In some of these neighborhoods around here, 90% of young black males are going to wind up in jail on probation, on parole at some point in their lives. That's, mass incarceration is the equivalent of 1,000 Katrinas slamming 1,000 Ninth Wards. But who gives a damn? You know, until very recently, I've been talking about this for 20 years. Nobody was feeling me. Hey, Mom, whatever. You know, and then there were all the personal responsibility, pull up your pants and whatever, right? So those are examples of some of that empathy, you know, deficit, that in-group love, out-group indifference, you know, that is unconscious. Now, how do we get folk to say those members of the Ninth Ward are my brothers and sisters? I have empathy for them. How do we get them to say those guys locked up in those prison cells, you know, some of them, I took my class seminar up to San Quentin 4 or 5 weeks ago. You go into cells that are 6 by 10, 2 bunk beds on them, a 10 toilet, and they're sometimes in here for 24, 48 hours at a time. You know, and let's not talk about what solitary is like and how Amnesty International has called it torture. It's routine practice for us, but we don't seem to have that empathy to do anything about it in the same way we did about Katrina. How do we build that?
So you and I have very difficult jobs, and no one's going to feel sorry for us because we teach at elite universities. But the reality is the combination of reason and faith is extremely challenging. People have been beheaded. If you look at the history of endowed professors, the first one who screamed on Henry VIII for being a bigamist, for wanting to get rid of his wife, they took his head off, all right? What I'm trying to say to you is that we find ourselves in a minority, not because of our race, but because of what we do. And we bring reason and data to bear to a public that is largely callous. We don't even have news anymore, really. They don't even try to pretend like it's news. It's like, you know, a soap opera or something. So we're talking about data. You know, I don't want to get Allen Iverson on you. We're not talking about practice. We're talking about practice. We're talking about data, right?
Yeah.
We're talking about evidence and the like.
Yeah.
And then we're going to people and showing them evidence, and then they're not responding, okay? So you have done it with your work in the courts. I've tried to do it in my community with the mapping. I make the mapping free. And people just now, after Ferguson, oh, where's your maps? You know, so it's very interesting problem. But the way I have back mapped it is this. And where I fell short was I didn't realize to get to action. And if you look at almost all social policies that have been passed, there have been some people with something special in them. They might have been moved by private actors, et cetera, but generally speaking, they go out on a limb to act to do good for other people. There almost hasn't been anything. Now, I admit, there are many public policies that came into place for in-groups helping in-groups that had a byproduct of helping out-groups. But I want to say this to you. I have never seen a public policy that has been put in place to help a quote-unquote out-group that didn't help the majority group. It defies logic. If you can find it, I'm buying Ruth Chris steak for you right now. I've never seen it happen. So I wonder often, are people just illogical? Because that's why I don't want to take reason out of this. I feel like people sometimes are. And then it's this state of being where you have to act to do good. And unfortunately, all of you, like us, have been socialized on the benefit principle. So we believe the only time we're supposed to help people is if they're part of our in-group, they pay part of whatever the taxing scheme is, then they get the benefit. There's no notion that we're gonna do good for other people. And that's why I think a transformation in your identity is just hugely important if we're ever to see people take the evidence that we bring to bear and make sense of it and do something. You have to have some kind of empathy. You know, logic and reason will take you so far. But if you don't have the empathy, there's no action. And you ask me, how do you get there? Well, I'm coming to you here in Veritas saying that I believe one way that you can get there is certainly a Christian life. If you have a Christian life and you don't have empathy for other people and you're not acting to do good for other people, I question that as a Christian perspective. There's a notion of fruit that's discussed in the Bible. What are you doing to help people? And I think that's extremely important. So that's what I'm saying. Now, some might say there'll be those of you in the audience who may never want to or aspire to be a Christian. Well, you still can do good for people. There have been many, many fine things done for people in our society who are not Christian, right? But I'm just saying the way that I've gotten there to deal with all the pain, hurt, and the things that I had to deal with my own personal identity was to go through Christianity. That's my point.
What do you say to people, Bill, who argue, and you know, this is a forum for, you know, really getting down into the nitty-gritty of the discourse and the back and forth of these colloquies, folks who say to you, like Azalea Banks in some of her tweets a little while back, said essentially that Blacks who are Christians are Uncle Toms. okay, because slavery is endorsed in the Bible, Old Testament and New, mm-hmm. right? I have the language. My RA just, texted me the language. You know, it's powerful language about beating them with a rod, but not quite till they're dead, and that's okay. It's powerful language, right? The charge people wrongly, in my opinion, but level at things like Islam when they talk about militant Islamic radicals. These people are saying you can say that about the Bible, Christianity, when it comes to how it's been used in the oppression of blacks through slavery. It's been used by people to justify abortion clinic bombings. It's been used to justify a lot of harm in the world. So why should someone from one of these harm groups find comfort and solace and salvation in this book?
So there are multiple questions there. The first one, we jumped into the one on slavery and Christianity and Uncle Tomism. So let's go with that one first, and you have to remind me the others because I'm old and it's late in the day. But that question to me is always been an interesting one, because you've had people like Phyllis Wheatley who wrote, it was very good that we were taken in this sort of captive state and brought to America because there we found Christ. There, I've seen that argument. Phyllis Wheatley actually made it, the poet.
That's a scary argument.
I wasn't going to make that argument. I'm just providing context for my colleagues in the room. But the argument that I have related to it is twofold. Number one, you're a lawyer, you know about hermeneutics. The big question is interpretation. And so if you go and look at some of these contexts and provide historical interpretation, I don't think you will find anything in the scriptures that was equivalent to the slavery that unfolded in Western civilization and led to the African diaspora all over the globe. There's nothing ever been like that in the history of mankind. Okay, so they were not speaking about that. And I also think at its very root, if you think about how that unfolded, where you have people coming in from the outside, going into a place, basically stealing the lives of other people. Biblically speaking, theft is a sin. There's no way to justify that form of engagement with a population to bring them to serve you in that way, using a biblical point of view. Literally, it's theft. It's stealing, and the cruelty that was associated with it is nowhere aligned with anything that I think you could justify from a Christian point of view. Now, some will debate with me about that. I think that's my response to it. I'm not taking a Phyllis Wheatley perspective on it, it's sort of a predestination perspective in a way, but I think that you cannot justify slavery with Christianity. And by the way, you and I know that those same arguments were laid out all throughout the South to justify Jim Crow and the like. A great book on it, Divided by Faith, by colleagues at Rice. I think that it is absolutely deplorable and a misinterpretation. And let's just be honest about something, because we're going to be honest here. It's an absolute failure of many Christian leaders in these environments that allow for that to happen. If you said nothing during that time just to keep the pulpit, you failed. It's an absolute failure. And any denomination that sanctioned it or turned a blind eye failed. They did not walk the walk, and it's shameful, and they really should repent. And I mean that. I mean deeply. It's really troubling that you still have people acting like, oh, you know, we were there. No, you weren't saying anything. I can look at the video. This stuff is on TV. You can watch. You can see who was out there. You don't have to debate about who was present. So I think that is extremely important. And that's why I think today's time is important also for Christian leadership. Because if you're silent now about all the things that have been transpiring, then there I have to question, really, are you being transformed day by day, washed in the Word, and living it out? Because I don't see how you can see some of the things that I see in this society and not be outraged, angry, and saddened and respond. It just doesn't seem like that would be a Christian walk to me. If you could do that, why bother? I mean, just go do what you do. It doesn't make any sense to me. So I think that we have current analogs in some places today. And that's why some of the young people are frustrated, because they can see the hypocrisy. You say one thing, and you're talking about this stuff like, oh, we serve Jesus and he served others, but then you do whatever you want to do and you don't seem to care. Are you in the prisons? Christ said, are you there with the people? He said these things. Are you there washing the feet of those who are less? I mean, all of this is, it's hard to be a Christian is what I'm saying to you. And so we have to ask ourselves, everybody might have the banner out, but I'm not sure everybody really is living it. And there is the challenge if I'm a young person, you know, a college-age student, how do I decide that this is something I want to do? Well, I would say to you, if you don't want to live a hypocritical life, go for it. I mean, this is a place where you really can make a difference and be transformed and be able to deal with all the outside pressures, because I firmly believe that the Spirit will dwell in you, that it'll allow you to be able to do the things that God would have you to do to move forward in a positive way the society he has created. That's what I believe. But you know, who am I? Just a guy from the south side of Chicago.
whose life seems to, you know, express blessing, right? And so, and that's one thing that can't be denied. On the one hand, on the other, people say, well, do all the other folks who were trapped and never got out, do they deserve so much less? You know, is it a kind of desserts thing? But let me back up and give you the second part of that question. The broadside on religion generally, you know, a lot of people have run with Charlie Hebdo as proof that faith is intolerant. Faith leads to intolerance. That, you know, faith is about absolute certainty. And as one of my wags used to say, you know, doubt may give your dinner a funny taste, but it's certainty that goes out and kills. It's that absolute certainty and righteous certainty in my cause and what I'm doing that seems to make it possible for people to do some of the things that we find shocking. So, you know, Bill Maher, you know, Richard Dawkins, you know, Christopher Hitchens. I mean, we can go down a long list of names out here taking that kind of shot again and again at all. You know, if somebody, you know, if the KKK is burning crosses and standing behind Christianity and doing what they're saying, see, that's what faith leads you to. And then they're pointing out to, you know, some terrorist group over here, see, that's what faith does to you. So, you know, what's your response to this idea that faith-based communities have seeds of intolerance in them?
So, because I'm not in all of those faith-based communities, I'm hesitant to answer for all of them. But let me start with the Christian one, and then maybe we can go out from there. If you are a Christian, I started with the parable, you know, the Good Samaritan parable. Here's the context in which it's pretty straightforward. You know, how do you love someone? You know, that question is provocative. That is not a trivial question. You know, you do good for them. And so this notion of being intolerant in the sense that people come from all different perspectives and the like, I'm still called to love them. I'm really called to love them. I think a lot of people make a mistake and say, I'm called to judge them first. But really, the call is to love. I mean, one famous quote that I use, it was how I thought about my kids, is like, rules without relationships lead to rebellion, right? So I firmly need to be in relationship with you. I need to love you fully. And if in that love, you and I come to some agreement about, you go to the absolutes now, or you come to some agreement about a doctrine, in love, I can talk to you about that doctrine, but my love should never be questioned. It should never be a doubt that I love you. Just like, you know, with your child and you're talking to them about something, you want them to go a certain way, they should never have a doubt that you love them. And it's the same way in a Christian walk. That love needs to be so powerful with people who are not necessarily Christians. They could be in other religious groups. They could not be religious. I don't want to be in a situation where I'm debating with a secular humanist and he doesn't think I love him or her. I need to love them. And I think that is the paramount scenario, because you cannot really talk to someone about what you really believe unless you have really shown love. And I think that's where a lot of Christianity, and perhaps some of these, I don't want to talk about other faith groups, but that's certainly a shortcoming. If you don't have love, what do you have? And what does love mean? It means to do good for someone. I'm going to help you. I'm going to be supportive of you. I'm going to show you that I care for you. And I think that part is woefully underdeveloped in American Christianity overall. We need to refocus in on love.
Let me ask you one more kind of big picture, broad question along those lines. You brought up hermeneutics earlier, new interpretations. We have to reinterpret, as we go along and redefine ourselves and maybe even in a sense reinvent ourselves. And this is a question that Veritas asked me to ask, make sure that I ask, and because this is an important part of something that they think about a lot and we've had from the very beginning. When you're grappling with questions of faith, do you keep an open mind, as you're, regardless of what faith you were born into, are you on a search, a quest, and not being bound by even that happenstance of birth as you're looking for religious truth? Or do you approach religious truths as pickles somehow? People discover them, they find these truths, and they pickle them and put them on a shelf. So nobody, we don't have to go back to those and revisit, because we already have the pickle truth, So pick a religion, pick a barrel of pickles.
Yeah, I got you.
Right? And or do we actively, each time around, each generation, each year, are we all called upon to actively search and research for the truth?
I think it's the latter. I think that the reason I do Veritas is because of the notion of reasoning and faith coming together. This is USC, one of the world's finest universities. It would be shameful for me to stand up here and tell anybody in this audience that they should not use the reason that they have been given and press in diligently to discover what they think about the existence of God, the importance of Christ. It's a choice that should be informed by your reason and study. Now, where I would jump on you if you were in my class, I would say, now, have you used your capabilities to really study and find out? I meet with young people who they have come to a faith in Christ, but they're still pressing in, looking at historical documents, questioning certain movements in Christianity and why they exist and why they shouldn't be a part of one part of this and a part of another, because they really are wrestling with this whole thing. If you take a good class in European history, you see all the different documents and the like. And I think that that's good. And that's what we should be doing. And if you're doing that and you're spending your life in that way, that helps to shape your identity and what you believe in. I think that's what this is about. I mean, I think this life is a journey in that way. I'm still on it. I'm still learning. I'm ever questioning everything. I mean, everything's up for grabs. I haven't had any doubt about my belief in Christ, but the surrounding aspects of some of the stuff that manifests itself in our culture, I have major questions about. And I constantly say, well, why is that a part of this? And where did that come from historically? And it doesn't seem like that excludes this group, because, I mean, look at some of the documents by Luther. I think I told you at lunch about my son who was reading. He's only 18. He's not coming to USC, so don't try to get him. But he's reading these original texts, of Luther's comments. And one of the things he said to me, he said, you know, there's some very disturbing remarks in here about certain ethnic groups. Mm-hmm. And this is troubling to me. Is there a way for me to actually serve the Lord and not deal with any of that? And this thing has been a journey. I mean, as a parent with him. So I think we should encourage that. I think it's extremely important. One of the things I usually say at the end of one of the Veritas form I've done, they ask you, what do you like about this? It's so special. And I think it's the form in which we really can promote and cheerlead you actually going out and studying to show yourself approved using all kind of text and doctrine to come to some real understanding and make a choice. This is about a choice. And so you should inform yourself. You shouldn't do it in ignorance. And that's what's exciting, and that's what my journey's been about the whole time.
I want to keep picking your brain, but I'm getting stage directions that it's time for me to turn you over to them, and that's a good thing. And
maybe, I don't know what the questions are yet, you know, this is...
have some questions come in from the audience, and I'll defer to...
Thank you. Thank you. So we'd like to continue this incredibly important, provocative conversation by asking students to ask questions. There's a microphone here, and you can text in your questions. There are two students who have prepared questions, and I'd like for them to start us off. Gurleen Chadha from the Sikh Student Association, Allison Rosen from the Secular Student Fellowship. So if Allison and Gurleen could approach the microphone on the left and ask your question, we'll get started. So.
Hi there, my name is Gurleen Chadha. I'm an undergraduate here at USC. And my question is, so one of the responses we've seen to Ferguson in New York is different minority groups coming together in solidarity. The hashtag Asians for Black Lives comes to mind. So faith can serve as a bridge to encourage participation in these movements, but it may also alienate those that don't identify as Christian or even spiritual or religious. So my question is, do you think that the addition of faith to the conversation serves to strengthen or weaken support for movements like Black Lives Matter? Thank you.
Wow, great question. You take that, Bill.
Sure. So social movements are very interesting, those of you who study them. Usually there's something that happens and some tragic event or some highlighted event, people are outraged, they join it, and then generally over time, they waver. They either splinter, or it's resolved, or they become disenchanted and they do something else. I mean, it happens over and over again, but change happens that way as well. My point to you is that I think it's vitally important, regardless of someone's faith identity, that on this particular topic that they would actually coalesce and work together. But I will say to you, and this is what I offer, those who will stay the course will have something different about them than those who leave. And there are some who their hearts will be changed. They will begin to view people in different ways, and they will stay true to the endeavor. I believe that oftentimes it is the person who has a faith walk that they look at issues and they just become really passionate about it, and they are emboldened and they can stay the course with it. But I do understand why you would think that there might be tensions, because if we can only join if we believe in, you know, the God that you believe in, that would be a way of splintering. But I do believe that some events bring people together across religious lines, racial lines, and the like, because they're so, in this case, painful and outrageous that as humans we are called to engage for human purposes. But you will see as you engage in this that some will fall off and some will stay the course over time. And you can look at many of the areas that where people have persisted, and I think you will see there is some correlation with them actually having a faith walk. But so I'm answering your question in two ways, I hope.
Yeah, I just say that to the extent that Black Lives Matters, Black Lives Matter encompasses the two core issues of police brutality and mass incarceration. I think the twin scourges of the Black community right now, you know, would be police brutality and mass incarceration. Certainly, the police brutality piece can be helped by any approach that gets officers to start to love Black kids. Connie Rice here in LA, who's now working with the LAPD, she sued them for years successfully, and she said, I wasn't making any changes. I was winning cases, but they weren't changing their behaviors with these people on the street. And now, in working with them, she said, you know, what it's clicked for me is necessary is these officers have to not just like, love these Black boys that they're patrolling, right? And she's worked on programs, there's a picture on LA Times about a year ago with this officer who back in the 80s and 90s would admit to you that he was hardcore, broken windows, you know, don't spit on the sidewalk, you're down on the asphalt. You know, don't jaywalk, you're down on the asphalt. They had him a picture of him in the LA Times running through Santa Monica's beach with the waves behind him with two Black kids under his arm, one under each arm, and all of them laughing and enjoying themselves. He's going to think about those kids differently now, you know, that he's bonded with them like that. He's starting to love Black boys, you know, and I think that, you know, a good number of officers are Christians and other faiths, you know, a good number. And so, you know, kind of bringing that home, and then mass incarceration just goes back to, you know, for me, Paul, Saul, redemption, you know, forgiveness and all of that.
Mm-hmm. Allison?
Hi, I'm Allison Rosen, and on behalf of the USC Secular Student Fellowship, I have a question about this forum's apparent assumption that the Christian narrative is a valuable asset when it comes to overcoming racism and other forms of discrimination. While Christians like Wilberforce and Dr. King have led many civil rights movements, in most instances, the oppression they fought against was championed by their Christian brethren, whose arguments for slavery and segregation were equally well supported by the Bible. As we've seen most recently in the case of gay marriage, God's will is generally a matter of interpretation. Our core problem, however, is the moral certitude Christians and other peoples of faith regularly claim on the basis of divine revelation. God said it, I believe it, that settles it. It's simply frightening to us, even when the believer is saying it is on our side of an issue. After all, Blaise Pascal once put it, men never do evil so completely and cheerfully as when they do it from religious conviction. As far as I can tell, such conviction is built into the structure of religions like Christianity, which rely on objective, immutable divine revelation, and therefore tend to resist the scientific imperative to change our minds, policies, and behaviors on the basis of new data or changed circumstances. So then my question to both of you, Dr. Tate and Dr. Armour, is why you think the framework of Christianity, including its dangerous claims of objective, immutable truth, is part of the solution to racism rather than part of the problem.
So that's a wonderful question, which I would ask a different question. So what framework would you use that would allow for you to engage the racial, you mentioned race, I guess, racial discrimination? Is there an alternative framework which is not based on truth and not immutable that you could bring to bear that would provide a robust effect?
Well, something like we have right here at USC, as a part of the Secular Student Fellowship, we believe that it is evolutionarily right, and evolution supports the doing good in the community, and we think that through reason and logic, it's logical to be a good person. It's logical to help your neighbor and be a good person. So we think that's framework enough.
So, okay, you just jumped all in my lane now, so we can get it in here. So now, you brought up evolution, which there's biological notions of evolution and then social notions of evolution. My assumption, and I don't want to make any assumptions, is let's deal with the social notion of the biological application in context. In the early 1900s, the American Breeder Association met in my city, St. Louis. I think about this in relationship to Ferguson, where they literally met pastors who had bought into the evolutionary notions that they put forward, really solidified a theology of eugenics that was so powerful that Hitler came here to learn from us based upon these ideas and manifest them over in Germany and throughout Europe. Social construct is one of the most dangerous ideas that you could ever put into place, because in the end, there's always something weaker by definition, and that weakness must be exterminated if you are to have strength in your society. Evolution is exactly why we're where we are today on the social front, because most of our policies have been put in place to take care of those who we define as good and worthy, and to marginalize and minimize those that we view as weak and less than. That's evolutionary thought, logically played out, cold, calculated, and on point. And I think it is dangerous. Quite frankly, most of our social policy, the way we've done it, has been that way, even here in the US. And so I worry that that application goes out into a public forum. It is why we have these people in jail. The whole idea of this is to basically, because we know this, mental health, let's just take that for a second. Because evolution says you sterilize people in the eugenics movement, and you get rid of the people who have mental feebleness. That's the whole idea. All right, guys, let's be real here. I'm an epidemiologist. The number of psychiatric disorders that have onset in teen years is through the roof. If you have that same disorder here at USC, you will receive the best possible care. You will get all kinds of services through your parents' resources, through the university. Everyone will care for you. You will not be treated as a feeble-minded person in the eugenic scheme. If you are African-American and you are 18 years old and have an onset of that, probably had it when you're 16, you're in the juvenile justice system, the largest mental health care services in the United States, one of the three largest, is right here in this county. Four 16 and 17 year olds, if they were USC bound, they would be getting clinical help. They're instead in jail. That's eugenics played out on an evolutionary scheme in real time. That's the danger of this. That's the danger of it. I worry about it. I think about it all the time. And in every class I teach, I always bring up the evolutionary idea applied in social context. It is dangerous. And it has resulted in a bifurcation in our society that is so profound that we take it as accidental. I worry about that. I worry about that. And I worry about it for my community, where the American Breeder Society were right there at the turn of the century calling for this, and here we have Ferguson. These things really play out in real time. They have real implications. There's no reason to have empathy for anyone if you believe in an evolutionary perspective applied to social context. You simply want to get rid of them. They're feeble-minded, they're weak, they don't have the intelligence, they don't have this, they don't have that. They don't have the right hair, they don't have the right size. Obviously, I care about this. That's my point.
Let me just follow up with that question. You're talking in terms of social evolution and eugenics. I think that's one extreme example. But aren't we also arguing for a type of psychological or spiritual evolution that does create empathy? We have evolved technologically. I feel like to some extent we haven't had a corresponding spiritual or psychological evolution. So many of the same traps that we've fallen into historically in terms of the way we treat each other, we're doing it to each other with, you know, better technology, but we haven't caught up in terms of our spiritual technology. So isn't there an aspect of evolution that is personal, that is psychological, that leads to empathy, and that doesn't necessarily have to happen in a theistic context? And the reason I say this is, I know Allison asked the perspective from the secular student fellowship. I've lived in India as a Buddhist monk. Buddhism is a non-theistic tradition, but it's predicated on compassion. The person who I consider my spiritual teacher is the Dalai Lama. We hosted him here at USC several years ago. He is the most empathetic person I've ever met. but he's doing it in a non-theistic framework. So what about that counter narrative to the problem of eugenics?
But you asked two different questions. So the Dalai Lama is empathetic. I'm not sure how he got to that point, but that's perfectly fine. If it's an empirical fact, he's empathetic, that's great. But there was a question about evolution. Mm-hmm. Now, you framed it and asked it about sort of a psychological evolution around empathy. I'm not a psychologist. I do have a background, you know, in sort of psychiatric epidemiology. My friends in psychology do say that there are evolutionary ideas that apply over time and that people sort of become empathetic. However, here's the dilemma I have with those studies. They're doing experimental design in a context devoid of history, right? They weren't doing those same kind of experiments 200 years ago, 300 years ago, 400 years ago. I don't know how you can say you believe in evidence, and that's all you believe, and then link it to an evolutionary perspective on psychology when you have an experiment, I can see you doing it, I know it happened in real time there, and maybe 10 years before somebody did it, and the literature stops, you know, 100 years ago, 150 years ago. How do you know that this is evolutionary concept? Because you built your whole paradigm on evidence. And I don't know where you're gonna get the evidence from. It's illogical. And I just struggle with that sometimes when I listen to them and they frame everything in psychology as the evolving of humankind. I think they've gone a bit far. I typically, and I probably won't be able to go back to Wash U now, my gosh. But my bottom line is I don't see the evidence. And if you're gonna build your paradigm strictly on evidence and not on faith, then I need to see the evidence. And you can't tell me how people were 500 years ago or 1,000 years ago using experimental design. You just kind of made that up because there's a broader theory that seems to fit into what you want to do. I have a real trouble with that. And if any psychologists are in the room, let's get it on right after this, because I don't believe a word you're saying on this stuff. I mean, I really have some serious doubts about it. I need the evidence.
Fair enough. So, yes, our next question.
Yeah, we had people text in questions, so thank you guys for doing that, and you can continue to do that. One of the questions we got was to Dr. Tate. Dr. Tate, have you ever doubted your faith, especially in light of the fact that so many Christians still seem unempathetic? What if I'm not convinced that God is able to change me and people around me who say they are Christians?
So there are multiple questions there. I may have to, again, I told you it's late in the day. So the first one has, have you ever doubted your faith? Yes. Do you want to know when? Is that? No, I mean, I there's two prayers I have, I mean, that I consistently do. I mean, one is, you know, to show me the way. And the other is, you know, I have doubts. You know, we all live in real time. I mean, if anybody here is a parent, I know you've doubted your faith. You know, I mean, this is a hard job being a parent. The things that unfold, the manifestation of the kids and their folly. And you're just like, Lord, help me. What is going on here? I mean, you know, I prayed about that and it's not happening the way I was hoping it would happen. You're going to doubt. You know, I've been praying for this kid and praying for this kid and praying for this kid and hoping and dreaming, and it's not going to happen. Something bad happens. Sure, you're going to doubt. And I think that's where you have to really come back and read and pray and be in community with other people where you can express this doubt without being judged and just go back and forth in that way. I think that's extremely important. And one of the uniqueness of a true Christian community is this ability to have fellowship with one another and really talk through whatever you're dealing with and pray about it and study and get through it. And that's part of the whole design of Christianity. And you can't be a Christian by yourself. Because you will have doubt. You have to be in community. And so I encourage those who might be in doubt, you know, get in community, talk with people. They don't all have to be Christian. You're just talking and really trying to work through it. But it's important, I think, to have someone who can mentor you and talk you through those scenarios. And then what was the next question? I'm sorry.
Yeah, next question.
There was two. It was the doubt.
Was what if I'm not convinced that God is able to change me and people around me who say they are Christians? It's the following part of the same question.
Now that's a really, wow. So let's deal with the person yourself, you know, your individual self. because people around you, the first thing you have to work on is you. I think as you study the scriptures and pray and you get in community, the transformation of ourselves, depending on who we are and our personality types, personality, I brought it up at least. Some of us, our will and our just the way we're made, our whole composition, change is very slow. And the process is very slow. But I believe in evolution with a small e for sure. We are definitely changing. You're changing because of the people you're around. You're changing because of what you read. You're changing because of what you experience. So I don't believe you're ever in a state where you're not changing. You're constantly ever consuming information and becoming different. And so that transformation process might not look the same for you as it does for someone else, but you are being transformed one way or another. And let me be clear about something. Whether you're a Christian or not a Christian, you are evolving, and by default, a world view is manifesting itself within you. And I'm using evolution with a small e here. I don't want to get into that debate right now unless the question comes up. But if you don't believe that there's this, that's just, I think it's a biological fact. Our neurons are firing in different ways. We're connecting. We're seeing different things. We're constantly in a state of change. Some of us, our neurons are not connecting as well as they were before, right? I mean, we're all transforming. And I think that the key is if you desire and you've made a choice that Christ is going to be the center of your life, you can transform in a way in community, reading and working with others, that you become closer and closer to what a Christ-like life would look like. And so I firmly believe we're always being transformed. Each of you. So you have a default worldview. If I went and gave a worldview question, each one of you will have one. And if I gave you one in 5 years, it may be a little bit different. We're all evolving. Those around you, good luck. They're changing too, is my point. We're all changing. And we change in community. So the community that you're in, here at USC, you're going to evolve. And then you're going to go out in real world, and you might be working with lawyers or like me, with social scientists. We're all evolving and changing.
I just want to say thanks for this. This is awesome. I'm a graduate from USC, graduated 2012, and there's been a lot that's been running through my head hearing you guys talk and the discussions and the questions. A couple things I just wrote down. I wanted to get your thoughts about them. The first was you guys were talking about empathy, and Varun, you even brought up the fact that the Dalai Lama is one of the most empathetic people that you know. And he doesn't claim to be a Christian. But for me, what I've learned is that, you know, and that's just from looking at the people around me and looking at history and looking at myself, is that there are those who claim to be working for God, but are actually doing the devil's work. And then there are those that claim to be not associated with God, but are doing everything that God asks them to do, doing God's work. And what I think that comes down to is, as human beings, we have a tendency to think that the way we see things, or the way that we think, or the things that we label are the way that they are. And that's not true. It's beyond us, but we can't see outside of it. Which brings us to the question of empathy, right? Which is what we're wrestling with here tonight, is how do you care for somebody else? And not just somebody else, we went further than that, but somebody that's so different from you. Somebody that's so far removed. And I think intrinsically, when you talk about the worst case scenarios, right? You have genocides and all that stuff. That all resonates with us as wrong, because we're all people. We all share that. We can't hide that. We can't run from that. So when we see babies being killed, when we see certain things, we respond to it. But there is that disconnect that exists between all of us because of the flesh that causes these issues that you see in our society between inequality that we're talking about here today. And I guess, hold on, I gotta go back here because it's a lot. I'm trying to say this as succinctly as I can. Jesus addressed the question of in-groups and out-groups, right? And his answer to that was that you're supposed to treat the in-group the same as the out-group. When he says you love not just your friends, not just your family, but you love your enemy as well. And there was a sort of an encouragement for us to go out and try to love people, to do our best to expose ourselves to other realities, to go and love other people, and you know, to grow in that. And I support that, and I think that that's great, but I think that that's still not the whole picture. I want to get your thoughts on this. I want to know, how do you go, because I've been on mission trips, I've facilitated mission trips, and you run into the issue of people go over and they experience it and they're changed in some manner. They come back different, but then at the end of the day, they're still removed from it. They're still sort of apart from that. How do you get to the point where it doesn't have to take genocide for you to care for the next person? How do you, the subtle insensitivities that create these unjust social structures and policies? And it goes beyond, I feel, our effort to make ourselves care. I think what it centers on is sort of our humility and our experience of God. I wanted to know, in a personal relationship, and I wanted to know what you guys thought of that.
Well, certainly empathy is a capacity that can grow through exercise, right? If you think of empathy as kind of a matter of the heart, care and concern for others, love for others, you know, if it can be metaphorically represented as a heart, that heart can grow, but it takes, you know, you got to work it. You know, just before I came over here, I was over at Culver City walking that hill. Y'all know that hill? You know the steps? I was doing the steps. You know, trying to build my capacity, physical capacity. I think you can build your capacity for empathy. One of the ways I would recommend, the way I do anyway, but you know, art. You know, that's why I put on Race, Rap, and Redemption. I think through art, through exposing yourself to others' narratives, other stories, through books, through films, you know, engaging them and trying to sympathetically identify with people who are outside your skin through art, you can build your capacity for empathy, right? And by voraciously seeking to increase your care and concern for others through those kinds of activities. So that would be just kind of off the cuff for me, but I'm gonna turn it over to true experts. This true expert, and then.
Small things. You know, not everybody will be called to go out and necessarily do what you're doing, like in a justice project in a penitentiary situation. But we're always surrounded by people. And the extent to which you listen and engage with those who you have been given as friends and classmates and the like, that's a huge deal. And I think you grow in empathy in that way. Some of you could not listen to anybody more than a couple of minutes. You need to practice to get to 4 minutes and 5 minutes. In 6 minutes, in 10, and then 20, and then a half an hour, because you're gonna find in the course of your life that you will receive some phone calls that will be shocking to you, and that you will have to have empathy, and you will need it desperately for the circumstances that you're in, and that somebody you love is in. And this thing is like a muscle. I like your metaphor. You build it up over time. I think that's extremely important. And back to the other question, it's part of the transformation. You're constantly building it up. I also want to take the time to say my remarks about evolution and my colleagues in psychology and the young woman who asked the question, as I was sitting here pondering it, she doesn't know me. And so I want to say to you and the whole group, the passion that I displayed was empathy. It was not, I wasn't trying to win a debate. Literally, for her and for others who might march on that, I literally am like, oh my gosh, this is not what you want. And so, so if I seemed emotional at the time, I was, because that was my empathy. And it's not that I'm trying to win a debate up here or anything like that. It's really about the ideas. And for me, another way empathy unfolds is when I hear it and I know the rabbit trail that a person might be going on if they follow away. I just well up with, I'm just like, I've got to try to help you. And I can't make your decisions for you, but I can tell you about the idea and where it's headed and how it played out historically. And that's the passion I get. That's why I love being a professor. It's just a tremendous job. You all know what a professor is? Really, do you know?
No.
There are multiple definitions of a professor. One, the initial definition, because the universities, Veritas, was started, they're professors of law or theology, people who teach that. But the other definition of professors comes from Christian, one who professes Christ, the professor. And I get to live both in real time. And it's just a powerful thing, but it's an obligation. And I don't want it to seem like, and that's why I'm saying this about to the young woman. I'm not debating. I don't want to do that. I, as my professor of one who professes Christ, I just have empathy. Because I know in my other life as a professor, the one who deals with the law a little bit and like, that course, where it's headed.
So we are out of time, but I do want to ask our distinguished guests one question to close us out, and I'll ask it to Jody and then to Bill. Same question. In my role here as Dean of Religious Life, I have the honor of overseeing over 90 different religious and spiritual groups on campus, working closely with over 50 different chaplains. And what I've noticed about our generation of students is they want to translate creeds into deeds. They want to translate what they believe into how they act in the world. They're interested in connecting meaning and purpose, not just to what they do as people, but what they do as professionals. Can you speak directly to our students who are here today and talk to them about the extraordinary opportunities that they might have at a research university, both in a curricular and extracurricular context, to think deeply about empathy, to practice empathy, and to think about how that translates in very real terms in terms of the work that they're preparing to do when they leave?
Yeah, well, in a university setting, we're committed to the value of critical self-reflection above all others. Critical reflection, and included in that critical self-reflection, and that's part of the project of revising yourself as a Christian, for that matter. You're constantly engaging in critical self-reflection and self-revision based on the products of your critical reflection. So certainly here in this university setting, you have an opportunity to get to the bottom of things in a way that you're not going to have a chance once you get outside these walls. I look back on, we kind of became lifelong students. We became professional students. But I talk to a lot of my law students who've graduated now, and they say, you know, what I really miss about school was the chance to stargaze, to think. You know, when you get out here in the work world, you're putting one fire out after another. You know, you really are. You have very little time for this kind of capacious, you know, critical self-reflection that you can engage in this context. And we try to find some of the best professorial minds in the country, as you do at your great university. And then most important, beyond those minds who are writing and talking in the classroom, we try to surround you with the best other students like yourself we can, because that's where really most of learning goes on. I learned more from my other students, both in undergrad and law school, I think, than I did from the pros. I did a lot of my own reading to teach myself the material, but the stuff I learned, I got from the student body around me. I think we have look at this. Look at this turnout. You know, for this kind of discussion, you know, this is what gives me heart, that you have, all you have to do is drop your bucket where you are. You know, as Booker T. Washington used to say, You know, all you have to do is drop your bucket where you are for in terms of resources for building and community and critical reflection and building that heart muscle.
So I travel to universities all over really the world, but in the US context, I notice something. For all of our admissions conversations about having diversity in classes and the like, and the miscegenations to make sure that that happens, what I notice is even when I go to the gym to play basketball, how segregated it is. I notice there's a court with the Asian students playing basketball, and then there's sometimes a court where the black and white students are playing. If you can play, you can play with them. And then there's another one for the people who are really horrible. And but this thing manifests itself everywhere, right? So then it's, you go to the cafeteria, we don't have cafeterias anymore. You guys have nice restaurants and the like. It's not like my day. And you see the same thing. And you go to the fraternities and sororities, and you see the same thing. And you go to all of the different entities, and you see segregation over and over and over again. Despite people like you and me fighting to make sure people have access to these places, it's still broadly segregated entities. And I have to tell you, it's heartbreaking. I just ask one thing, that take whatever you think is your in-group and spend some time with some people who aren't in it. Just that simple. This is your last shot at it where you really can do that, and it was a life-changing experience for you if you do. And when you leave this place, you will be able to do things very differently than your colleagues who did not take that on. I just think that's a huge deal. You might say, what does that have to do with Christianity? Well, I started off saying you have to be able to love. And you can't love what you don't know. And so you've got to come into knowledge of it. And I just think that is huge. I think we're really saying the same thing. And I think that's spot on to end it.
Mm-hmm. When I was hired here at USC in 2008, they told me my job title was the chief religious or spiritual leader of the university. But I knew that wasn't true because there was really someone else here who has that role. He's become a friend and a mentor, and more than anyone I know, he embodies the notion of empathy. He's worked across racial and religious divides to really bring a great amount of healing to people, especially in our city. That's the Reverend Dr. Chip Murray. For those of you who don't know, Dr. Murray was the pastor at FAME. He started the congregation with 200 people. He grew it to 20,000 people. And more than anyone else, during the 1992 riots in South Los Angeles, that happened right here in USC's backyard, it was Dr. Murray who brokered the peace deals between the various groups that were on the streets. He's the one who used the church in a way to basically put out the fires. He had five sitting presidents come through his church. Because of the work he did in 1992, he was able to raise $400 million that was invested in South Los Angeles for job creation, for community development. And he, in my eyes, is a great civil rights icon who is living here amongst us. He is the director of the Cecil Murray Center here at USC. He's the Tansy Chair of Christian Ethics in the School of Religion. He is the chaplain to the chaplains here. And I've asked him to close us tonight with a benediction.
You are so beautiful. Thank you for caring. Thank you for being care packages. We thank our sponsoring organizations, our presenting lives, Veritas. Concept of caring, of sharing, of reaching out as family once you rise. Thank you, our Lord, for Veritas, truth. Thank you for your servant, disciple, apostle, John 8:21, who informs the ages, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. We tried the truth with the concept of the melting pot. It did not work. We must find a way for different folks and folks who are different, not to allow their differences to make a difference. And what is the difference? I could be carefree. I could be careful. I could be careless. I am called upon to be careful. And with the melting pot, it does not work. You put all of the ingredients into the pot. Then when the heat is on, everything must blend to the predominant culture flavor. We dare to look at the salad bowl, where each component is separate, different, yes, but each contributes to the whole. I am you, you are I. What do we do to each other? The salad bowl, lettuce, tomato, carrot, and let us teach us to say, let us feel the 30 million Americans who go to bed hungry every night. Let us feel the confinement of 2.2 million Americans in prison. 50% of them being black, 35% brown, from underserved communities, 90% of those blacks being there for nonviolent crime, substance abuse. And now we see that the prison system is overloaded, overcrowded, and we must release nonviolent criminals. Again, another challenge to find a door to avoid recidivism. With women's rights, husbands, you are in charge of women. No, no, women are to be silent in church. No, Paul, no. We agree with you, Paul, that you finally come to understand God has made all of us equal. In God, there is neither master nor slave, neither male nor female, neither privileged nor underprivileged. So we rise in that proclamation and declaration. And we leave on an umbilical cord attached to you, attached to each other. Thank you for our truth tellers tonight. Thank you for our truth bearers tonight. Thank you for every caretaker beneath this roof. In your name. In your name. Now let everybody get a hug. Hug your neighbor, family. Go ahead, hug your neighbor.
For more information about the Veritas Forum, including additional recordings and a calendar of upcoming events, please visit our website at veritas.org.